cold in here. It's nice. My best. No, the other day. No, second.
Oh, yeah. This order.
You're forgetting.
Yes. No, it's
what I thought. I'm passes when you're having fun. Welcome, everybody, to the Wilson Center. My name is Henri Baki. We have a challenging program this afternoon on the humanitarian challenges and the Mosul offensive. We have two speakers. Kelly Clements is the United Nations Deputy High Commissioner for Refugees. Previously, she was at the State Department. And Lukman Faily, who was the Iraqi Ambassador to the United States and is now a free man.
Long live freedom.
So you can read the rest of the bios, they're listed. So we'll start with Kelly, and this will be more of a conversation than actual presentations. There'll be short presentations to start, and then I'll ask a few questions, and then I'll invite the audience to do the same.
Thank you. Thanks very much. And thanks to everybody for coming and your interest.
Excuse me. I forgot one thing. I also would like to thank my colleague, Joe Cassidy, who actually helped organize this thing. I've been meaning to tell you.
Kelly is an old friend, so I'm happy to have her here.
Any of your old friends are welcome here.
Yes, Joe is the reason I'm here. No, we really do appreciate the interest in coming out today. Obviously, what is happening currently in Iraq and in Mosul in particular is of great concern to us. It is not unexpected, however. This is a situation working very closely with my co-panelists, former government, is something that we have certainly been preparing for some time. But putting it into the context of what's happening in Iraq generally, I think, is important in terms of humanitarian need and humanitarian challenges. The UN Refugee Agency has obviously been there for a very long time, been in the country and supporting the government and the people in terms of response, and dealing with displacement for quite some time. So in this context, obviously, of the Mosul offensive, we have over 3 million people, about 3.3 internally displaced persons, another 250,000 Syrian refugees, most of whom have found respite, protection, assistance in northern Iraq. And it is an environment that is tremendously challenging from the perspective of the humanitarian agencies in terms of response, in terms of access in some areas for reasons that you well know. So it's in this context that working very closely with the humanitarian country team from the United Nations and a large number of partners, both international partners, local partners, and with the support and leadership of the government, to try to prepare for what we knew would happen at some point, but we were not sure when. And that offensive started about a month ago. This was after 2 years of control by ISIL. And that was something that certainly we were planning in terms of worst case scenarios as opposed to best case scenarios. And in terms of worst case scenarios, our estimates are that anything from 1.2 to 1.5 million people could be affected. Putting this into the context in the country, there are some 10 million civilians currently in need of some form of humanitarian assistance, which those of you that are following very closely the work that we've done in collaboration with the government, there are estimated needs of over $1 billion, $1.1 billion. And in terms of preparation for this particular response, in terms of Mosul, about $400 million, of which about half of that is related to the UN Refugee Agency's requirements. I think in terms of those that on our planning, on the planning side, about 700,000 we have estimated may be in need of some form of immediate humanitarian assistance because they will be displaced. And so the work of the agencies have been very much, and again, I want to emphasize the collaboration that there has been with the government, is shelter, immediate non-food items, and so on. What we've seen in the early days, and it'll be very interesting to get the ambassador's perspectives on this, is not the extent of displacement in the early days that we expected. There are nearly 60,000 people so far that have been displaced from the offensive, and actually some returns already. This is something that I think it's fair to say is unpredictable, that we have to be tremendously flexible in terms of response, and our planning has been such. So when we've talked about where people might go, what they might need, this is not a normal humanitarian response by any stretch of the imagination. The other issue in terms of the response is the intention that the displacement be very short-lived in terms of time frame, which obviously we've cautioned in terms of not seeing returns happen precipitously, where it has presented safety concerns, security concerns on the part of those that do return. And that is something that we've been in very close dialogue as a UN team with the government to ensure, and obviously some of the screening procedures that have been put into place, we've emphasized the need to ensure that those returns certainly are voluntary and not discriminating. So that's been something that's been a big concern to us. The other issue, and I think the protection issues are paramount in addition to the assistance requirements for those that are displaced or may be displaced. We're quite concerned about access to those civilians that are in these sealed off locations and inaccessible and have been inaccessible now for some 2 years, and what their needs and requirements would be. So in terms of the ongoing military operations to try to figure out how it is we can actually get aid in has been a huge concern. Issues related to how civilians have been treated, how they're treated during combat, the concerns about civilians being used as human shields, the abductions that have taken place, and the forcible moves that our team on the ground and have certainly been reported are of concern. That, and I can't underestimate the concerns we also have about the minority populations and what may happen to them. The dialogue and the response in terms of with the government has been very strong, I think, both in terms of the access we have to the screening centers, but also in terms of the timing of returns. And that's something that we want to ensure is in place, because I think there's a strong concern about reports of revenge killings, forced displacement, secondary displacement, and summary justice that may happen in some of these communities. And that's been a concern for us for sure. I might also just say that in the context of Iraq generally, it's the middle of November. Winter comes every year. And in terms of our response across the country with the strong network of partners in place, we are exceedingly interested in making sure that we've got things in place as people are coming into some of the camps and settlements where they may be for a short period of time or might more likely a longer period of time. So winter plans have been key for us, making sure people have warm clothes and heating fuel and that sort of thing, which has been a concern. So I think on both angles, whether or not it's protection or assistance, if you were to ask, are we ready for much larger displacements? My answer would be, we're getting ready, we're not there yet. We're ramping up, and when I say we, I really do mean the royal we, in terms of the number of partners and supporting the government themselves running many of these camps, IDP camps, but the availability of land has been difficult. The difficulty in terms of trying to ensure that we've got the goods in key locations, again, trying to predict possible movements and secondary movements. And we're not quite there yet, but we think we can be in terms of 700,000 in the course of the next few months. So maybe I stop there and look forward to the discussion. And thanks again for your interest.
Thank you, Kelly.
Thank you very much, Henri. Thank you for the Wilson Center, and thank you, Kelly, for your
for your work, hard work, and for informing our American audience here as to what's taking place and what are the key challenges. From a geopolitical perspective, there are quite a few issues to watch out for. One is a sense of urgency. It is, in a way, sometimes it's lacking across the political parties to get their politics aligned, and sometimes in a sense of the scale of the challenge itself requires you to focus for it not to prolong. Iraqis, by their nature, don't feel like to be in displaced place. It's shameful. Forces on communities to take them on, so from an urban perspective rather than for them to stay in camps. However, sometimes they may be lost in the system as a result of such actions. So geopolitically, a sense of urgency does need to be emphasized by the government, on the government, and by the political parties, so that this issue does not become a prolonged suffering for the victims. On another issue, which is to do the scale of, from a geopolitical perspective, and its ramification to the regional aspect of it. There is close proximity to Europe, that in itself has its own ramification, as we've seen recently. There is a close proximity to the situation in Syria. There is a high dependency. The quarter of a million of Syrians have been there for some time now. So in itself tells you that this would be a prolonged, atrocious campaign unless you really sort of try to resolve the issues. We know that there is no end to the Syrian situation at this moment, unfortunately, and therefore these are a cost. On a geopolitical aspect of it, there is a significant contribution by the American who are driving this in the case of providing some funds and also with close cooperation with the United Nations. Also, the regional ramification to Turkey and its role, what does it want to play in Syria and in Iraq? There is some interdependencies. In a way, the victims are losing out of these political games and political short-sightedness. To me, that's the biggest challenge. On the other side, you have the ISIS, terrorists, and others have disregard to the humans. They are not there as a state protecting their citizens. So in effect, they are expendable and becomes, in a way, like it's like a, what you might call, no rule of engagement in how do they deal with these issues. And therefore, they become human shields. They become utilized where there are some who want to escape, terrorists who want to escape via these humanitarians, which becomes harder for the Iraqi government to deal with them. How do you go about distinguishing and so on? So to that effect, we do have a challenge. The good news from a geopolitical perspective is less sectarian as people try to project it. So these are they've been embraced by the various communities. The issue are primarily, to me, which I think Kelly mentioned, but let me reemphasize it, it's more intra-tribal rather than sectarianism, which is a challenge. So revenge, shameful, and as other aspects, these are intra-tribal. And our societies are, by their nature, are tribal-oriented. So there becomes an issue of honor and killing and so on. So there, what do you do? People sometimes perceive this as a sectarianism. It's in reality, it's more intra-tribal than sectarianism. However, we also have a strategic, from a geopolitical risk, of minorities and identities. Minorities doesn't mean only those who are, even Shia minorities, i.e. Turkmen, in that part of the world are being displaced. And so from an identity perspective, from a sort of diversity of Iraq, it becomes a threat. Then you have the other type of minorities, like Yazidis, who are minorities, and that's they become a victim as well. So my view is this is a strategic threat to the identity of the country, and unfortunately, if people lose sight of that and focus on the war against terrorism more than the ramification of the war against terrorism, then unfortunately, we will lose out. On another aspect of it, the government has shown a tremendous focus on people not to be displaced. So it becomes a prolonged war, a street-by-street war or a grid-by-grid war, so that people don't become displaced. We have learned that from the previous experience in Tikrit and others. It took us over a year to bring most of the majority of Tikritis back to their place. We still have issues with refugees, for example, in Fallujah and in Anbar. So to that effect, I think in Mosul we have learned the nature of the terrain itself is a wide open city may help, but at the same time it also becomes more problematic when ISIS or Daesh use them as a human shield. So to that effect, it's a longer campaign, maybe more, bloodier in that sense, and certainly requires a lot of patience and self-control. However, you also have that when ISIS use these people as human shields and others, it becomes more operationally rather than strategic. So it's up to the commanders on the ground how much they think they have to be patient and embracing and opening the sort of back doors for the refugees to trickle out rather than. And so in a way, it's not an easy operation. It's not as straightforward. I think the challenges we face are, I mean, geopolitically has straight ramification to terrorism. Terrorism is a global challenge. The international community need to view it as a long-term sort of counter-narrative to terrorism, including dealing with the humanitarian as a long-term rather than just as one case on its own. So there is a theme there which we need to focus on. We should not forget that the majority of the refugees are Iraq in itself are a young society. Majority, and I'm talking about young. I mean, the median age is just over 19. So it tells you that a substantial amount of these refugees are young, and therefore they may have the energy, they may have the durability, but at the same time they have aspirations and they have access to social media, so they know what's going on in the world, and they may say, okay, I need to be a refugee in Europe or elsewhere, or that the government is not providing me, and therefore I will join an armed group or whatever as another way of earning a living or forcing myself into earning some money there. Oil prices has been one of the strategic geopolitical adverse factors on us. It doesn't. It has not given the government ability to give sort of provide money to these issues, which also leads on to the international support. Some countries have made pledges. Some have really contributed, including countries like Kuwait and others. Others have made pledges, but it's more for us. When I view this, it looks more as a carrot for political dimension rather than an actual humanitarian contribution. So get your politics right; we will give you this money, type of things. And there, the victims are the people whom they are supposed to protect, and that's another problem we have. I think I will stop there, but I would like to say just one final point. The humanitarian aspect is not a new phenomenon. People have had a lot of in UN and others have always worked on it. But the phenomenon now we have is that people awareness, because of technology and others, becomes easier to identify and in one way easier to work with, providing you have the right infrastructure. And so where you are in providing camps and everything else becomes a crucial tool to alleviate the pain. And one thing I would say with confidence, Iraqis by their nature don't like to be refugees, which means that they will find a way to resolve it, but they need the support so that it becomes alleviate the pain while in this transition and while we have this global challenge of terrorism. Thank you.
Thank you, Lukman. Kelly, let me start with a two-pronged question for you. You said winter is coming. The
not here. Strong, right? By the way, it's 70 degrees outside.
So what is your expectation? I mean, you're not a military commander, obviously. I'm not expect you. But this fight may last much longer than we expected. Right. People thought that by the time the new president is inaugurated here, that Mosul will probably fall. That may not happen. It may take much longer. So that's I just want to think, how does UNHCR prepare itself for that, et cetera? But second, Lukman said something that's very interesting. That is, you're dealing with a very, very young population, right? So when you think about the humanitarian needs, so the humanitarian needs, some of them are immediate, shelter, food, basic needs. But then there's all these kids that need schooling, they need things that are in the long run much quite important in terms of saving that population from ISIS. And are you also involved in that aspect?
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Thanks for the questions. So winter, there are a couple of ways that we prepare, plan, respond in times like this that may be a little bit different depending upon the month. First, the winter preparations begin far earlier than middle of November. So this has been underway for a couple of months already, particularly for those refugees already surplus, like the Syrians in the north, and the IDPs currently that are in some of these camps that we're building upon with the government in terms of additional capacity. What we would do differently as a humanitarian community is for example, the structures or the shelter that we may put into place. In winter months, we're looking at insulated tents, for example. It's extreme heat during the summer. It's very cold during the winter. The temperature changes are quite substantial. So there are the different types of inputs that we may provide. The type of not the relief items that we distribute vary quite considerably. In terms of distribution of heaters, for example, fuel has been an issue. Those sorts of things become critical in terms of making families as resilient as possible to the change in temperatures. And that all becomes part of our response package. And that's not just obviously the UNHCR, but that's the broad array of humanitarian responders. So in terms of the winter months, the winter package tends to be quite different in terms of the response. On the youth, very important question. And there will be a significant number of kids, but also young people. It is important for us, and one of the reasons in this, particularly this environment right now, globally, that we not look at this just in terms, first of all, education is not a secondary priority. It's part, emergency education is part of the immediate response. So while UNHCR is not in the forefront of that in Iraq, per se, there are other partners that are engaged, we find every way possible to try to keep the normalcy in place for those that are displaced. Now, what's going to be happening in the Mosul context would be quite different. What has been happening over the last 2 years to these families and to these children, we don't really know. And so as people are coming out, obviously, this is when the assessments happen, where we find out, you know, whether or not school has continued, what types of services have been provided, this sort of thing. We suspect very little. But that there is not just a need for basic education, but probably pretty significant psychosocial support, for example. Remedial education, ways to return normalcy to the lives of young people. So the education piece is quite important, and this is where the government of Iraq's support and engagement is so important, because we don't come in and build new schools necessarily, and it certainly doesn't happen quickly as an international community. We rely very much on the services of the host country, and in terms of being able to supplement, support Iraq's response to the needs of its people is a significant part of that. So we would look at the national services that are available in various communities. And again, this is a population that's very much, it's very dynamic in terms of its movement. It may not be in place for longer than a few weeks, a few months. And the intervention that we may have on some of these national service, social service type injects would be quite different than in a, if I can say, a normal displacement situation. This is quite different.
Just a quick follow-up. Yep. You said that there's already been 60,000 people.
Yes.
So you must have interviewed them by now. And what does those interviews tell you about what's been happening in terms of, let's say, education in those 2 years?
That would be probably an answer I wouldn't have a lot of detail on in terms of the education piece. But the service delivery is, of course, very important. So the camps that have been set up already, that those 60,000, about three-quarters have gone into camps. And about a quarter of the population is being hosted with families and in community centers and other locations. So what they've said is that the service delivery has been very minimal. So in terms of the services that we can put in place, whether or not it's education or health, the needs are quite dramatic. And I do want to emphasize the point that the ambassador made in terms of the support that is required for this response. It's not just putting people in insulated tents and keeping them warm through the winter, but throughout, this is the various pieces of a response have been under-supported by the international community. The U.S. has been one of the most important donors to this effort, the leading donor to this effort from a humanitarian response perspective, which has been critical. But we're still about 55, 60% supported of that appeal that I mentioned earlier, which means that there are going to be services and humanitarian responses that will go unfunded, which means there will be impacts felt. So I don't want to leave the room thinking that we'll get every child educated and every child a warm coat, because right now we don't have the money to support that.
Lukman, I did introduce you as a free man, so I'll put you a little bit on the spot. You gave essentially a rather optimistic picture in terms of that things are working, that it's not really sectarian, that it's mostly a tribal problem that you have. From your perspective, what's the worst case scenario as we go forward on this Mosul offensive in terms of the humanitarian or other aspects?
I personally don't think that Mosul is the last battleground, to be honest. So I think people need to be, there are other hotspots, whether it's in Tel Afar or Hawija or others as well. I did say that ISIS are able to think outside the box. So their ability to destroy other communities and sort of push them hostage is itself becomes a problem across Iraq. So in a way, that's a strategic threat we have from ISIS as an entity. Another issue, which I haven't talked about, which maybe I need to, and that a political vacuum still exists, a leadership political vacuum exists in these areas. Majority of the population do not now see the elected officials, democratic elected officials, as representative. And at the end of the day, how do you deal with them? Who are the community leaders, true community leaders, to take this? So to that effect, these are the strategic long-term threat I see. In one way, stabilization is a nice thing to have, and it's an important concept. And people talk about reconstruction thereafter, but I have not seen anything on reconstruction, which helped, which to me, and I don't think we'll see it for a long time. So to me, it means that this is a prolonged sort of generational challenge we need to think about. How do we deal with displaced people, and how do we deal with getting them back to normality? This is in a context of a culture of violence, by the way. So this is not unique. It's not like somebody had an earthquake or some humanitarian immediate threat which led to them be displaced. No, this is an extension of an already existing problem of terrorism, wars, and some element of civil wars and so on. So to me, that's the long-term ramification of people feeling that they are disgruntled, the service is not delivering, democracy is not working, and therefore, what do we do? So do we become a refugee elsewhere, we've seen that, and we have majority, by the way, a lot of people who are drowned in the Mediterranean are from Iraq and Syria. So we have seen the ramification of that, not just kids and so on. So the worst case scenario for me is immediately, if people think that we've liberated Mosul, ISIS is no longer a problem, let's move on to another problem in the globe. So international loss of focus on it becomes an issue. We as Iraqi players on our own will not be able to deal with it. I say that with full confidence and openness. Why? Because we still don't have a political leadership vacuum who are unable to comprehend the scale of the challenge and their responsibility to take this. So then who do you depend on? And the UN to lead the situation on the ground? The scale of it is too large. The terrain is different, and it's not the normal operation of refugees and to that effect. Plus, the people themselves are unhappy with, and they're not content, which is a good sign for me.
Thank you. Let me open it up for questions, and please identify yourself, and you'll get a microphone, I think.
And Diana Negroponte from here at the Woodrow Wilson Center. The application of Iraqi law to internally displace people is very hard. And I'm wondering where the boundaries lie between the application of the rule of law in Iraq and then within a camp run by the United Nations, whether other norms of international law take precedence. And that would be a question for Kelly. Thank you.
I mean, when I did say a sense of urgency is required, and I talked about political vacuums, sometime when I see in our own parliament debating issues which are so trivial and so insignificant, I do feel that these guys, where on which planet do they live? And the reason I'm saying that is the point you just talked about, which is the law and how do you go facilitate it. The sense of urgency in dealing with humanitarian and so on, people need to understand that. We, sometimes our officials do not understand the ramification of that, the socio-economic ramification, let alone not just the political ramification. So to that effect, we do need substantially to change our legislations to accommodate with these diversities. It's not just the law, by the way. It's sometimes say, okay, you have ISIS who go through these, or these are sleeper cells, and therefore they may not be allowed to come to this town or that town. In reality, if they are citizens, you need to deal with them as citizens, equal among all, regardless of the race, color, and so on. So to me, I think there is a culture change has to take place, political culture change that takes, that the government and the officials, regardless where they, who they represent, at the end of the day, they are civil service to the whole country, not to any ethno-sectarian background alone. So to me, I think I agree with you. There isn't a sense of urgency, specifically in Parliament, to deal with the ramifications. And it's one of the what you might call a structural problem in our political entity.
From our perspective, there is no difference territorially as to whether or not people are in camp-like situations, which may be organized, managed by the UN or another entity, and what would happen in an urban environment or those in settlements or with host families or what have you. Human rights law, international humanitarian law in terms of protection of civilians applies everywhere. And it's something that we obviously continue to advocate in close partnership with other actors.
Thank you very much. I'm Jim Scheer, Global Fellow here at the Wilson Center, and thanks very much to our panelists for a very illuminating discussion. A couple of quick questions. Number one, is there a good evolving partnership between humanitarians and the Iraqi government on the screening process? I know that was a big issue in terms of concerns about the so-called Trojan horse issue, and young male fighting age men are the issue. And I know there's some separation from families, but there's been a lot of concern about transparency. And I hope that's so. That would be my first question. Secondly, in terms of the day after governance for Mosul, I understand from prior experiences, the clearance of Ramadi and so forth, that the governor of the affected province would have a key role in this case Nineveh, I guess. And my question there is, how well is that preparation going on? And while I have the mic, I guess a third question, where will the ISIS foreign fighters flee to? Do we have a sense of that? Not the internal ISIL fighters, but is Jordan going to be at risk? Is Turkey, other neighboring countries? Oh, by the way, on the camp, solar lighting is great. I hope that's being worked, all right? Kelly and I were former co-conspirators. Stuff like that.
Sure. On the issue of screening, so this is an ongoing dialogue with the government, as you might imagine. I don't think we're there yet, to be honest. There needs still to be a clear national policy with regard to centers, with regard to access, with regard to who is actually screened. As it stands now, men and boys, 13, 14 years of age and up, are those that are screened. in terms of who can actually be part of that process with the government. That varies from center to center, and it's something that we're in close dialogue with the Iraqi government.
On the day after governance, I mean, the practice has been from Anbar, Tikrit, and Fallujah, and even in Nineveh, or the actual Nineveh, that the prime minister has more or less given all his authority to the governor to be able to manage the situation. In Nineveh, the scale of it, the politics, the diversity of the stakeholders makes it much harder. I personally wrote an article the other day in Iraqi media talking about this, and I said we need to have a political military governor for a year or two to get things in action because of the scale and there's so many players to deal with. I went out of my way. It might be elements of constitution and others need to be addressed. But to me, the current process dealing with the scale of what we have, I'm a bit doubtful. But also at the end of the day, you have democratic entities and you have to respect certain elements of that. There is some inner fighting going on politically within the Muslim politicians, Maslawi politicians, how do you go governing these issues? But I think I don't see a problem from the central government working with them. I don't see that as a problem. I see it more as an internal intra problem, which in itself may not be the most efficient way because of the so many diversity of stakeholders. As to the foreign fighters, a significant amount of them have already left Mosul, we know that much. And those whom are dealt with, there are different agreements with different countries. Do we hand them over? Some of them are stayed within Iraq laws. Do they have history we know about? So to that effect, it's ongoing. It's working in progress. I don't say there is a clear process for it. And certainly, the transparency becomes an issue as a result of that as well.
Thank you. This gentleman, and then that lady.
Thank you. My name is Dilmon Abdelkader, Research Associate at the Endowment for Middle East Truth. My question is for Mr. Lukman. Is there fear of a larger humanitarian crisis after the liberation of Mosul? Because what I've seen is that all eyes are on Mosul right now, from the Shiite militias, from the Turks, from the Kurds, Yazidis. Everybody has something at stake at Mosul. Is there something greater that the people should fear?
Thank you. When I look at this, I don't see it in a pure sectarian prism because I think it's a bit more complicated than that. There is an issue of power. There is an issue of revenge, and the revenge is not anything to do with sectarianism, that's a human feeling. There is an element of mistrust. That's on the bad side. On the good side, there is a much better understanding across all stakeholders that the fighting terrorism is no way a tool can be used for projecting power, so it's no longer working. There is zero sum is not working for us. So in one way, there is a better understanding we need each other. There is still a small amount of we can improve on negotiating and compromising with each other. I still don't see a lot of compromise, but I see a good understanding that we need each other and we need to define a working process. Here, interlocutors like the UN, US, and others and organizations becomes an important element to at least on the operational aspect of it. Forget about the global geopolitical aspect of it or a larger political aspect. At least on operational aspect of it, it becomes an important interlocutor, impartial as well.
Let me kind of change slightly the question. In Mosul, you've had 2 years of ISIS rule. And today there was an article in, I forget, with the Post or New York Times about this radio station broadcasting and people calling in with, you know, amazing heroism. And they're saying, for example, all my neighbors are ISIS. So it's not just some young man or older man, but it may be families that are ISIS supporters. So what if you have in a city of 1.5 million, let's pick a number, 400,000 ISIS supporters, what do you do with them?
To make it a bit gloomier, it's more than
500,000.
No, it's not that. It's just that it's not 2 years. It's the strategically speaking, Mosul was never gained by the government, apart from, I'm talking about politically, not militarily. So they were able to have that. And there is an issue, an intra-community issue, significant intra-community issue, in how do you accommodate terrorism for a short-term objective. So that's and that's a bigger problem here. That's a soul-searching question which we Iraqis have to go through, a very painful one. And 400,000 question.
What do we do with 400,000 or 500,000? This is not something that's unique to Iraq. I think we see in several situations guilt by association. And that, we've seen that historically in displacement populations, even the Great Lakes going back to the mid-1990s, and so on, that those who may be married to a militia or a rebel or what have you is assumed to then be a sympathizer or part of the same movement or what have you. And it's a very difficult discussion to have. But this is where the protection piece becomes so important. The issues related to who is assisted, who is not assisted. It's been, and I know there are some experts in this room who have tackled these issues far longer than I have. But it's something that, in terms of protections, we can't assume guilt by association. And in terms of basic humanitarian need, there needs to be a more sophisticated way to be able to identify those in need of international protection.
There is another element which I think is worthy of. I mean, 2 weeks ago, there was an example of some who were collaborating with ISIS, and their homes were destroyed. Then we had a lot of debate back in Iraq and social media, the legality, the ethicality of this aspect of it as well. Some justified it, because sometimes democratic countries do that as well, unfortunately. So for me, the key question here is the political roadmap track, call it reconciliation, aligned or faster than the issue of bringing back people into the system? Because if they are not, then if you don't have the leadership vacuum, and if you have a vacuum in leadership and so on, then it becomes up to you, vigilantes, to take ownership of these issues. So there is an important aspect where, for example, religious establishment, government officials, tribal leaders and others, to define a new operation or manual of rule of engagement, if that's the right way to use, in dealing with these situations. There is an opportunity for abuse as a result of people's interpretation. He was a collaborator, he was not, and that's the problem we have. There is an issue of pride that we have, then we have cleared our tribe from this element, from this sort of cancerous entity in us, in our tribe, and that's the element. And there is an element of opportunity of reconciliation, and the best time to do it is when you have real issues to address. So it's not becomes an exercise for the sake of it, but an actual exercise to address core issues. Here, the political roadmap of reconciliation becomes an important factor. I still feel, as I said, talked about the sense of urgency, that that political roadmap is not as fast as the military roadmap.
There was a lady here.
Hi, Stephanie Himmon from World Vision. I have a question about humanitarian access, and as it looks like the scenario of civilians in Mosul for sheltering place looks more and more likely. What is the humanitarian preparedness for the international NGO community to go closer to the front lines of Mosul distribute humanitarian relief to those civilians who may decide to indeed shelter in place in Mosul in the coming months?
That's obviously a critical issue, and for the last 2 years, it has been largely inaccessible. And so it depends on courageous organizations, including your own, in terms of the ability to move closer. I don't think the issue is so much supply. The issue is actually being able to move in and out safely. We rely tremendously, as a humanitarian community, obviously, on the government of Iraq for protection, for security, for the information to know where areas are safe or not. But we also rely very much on local partners, civil society, others that are close to the situation to know where we can go and where we can't go. And on any given day, it may change quite dramatically. In terms of, we've developed as a humanitarian community a rather unique set of nimble responses, particularly on the shelter side. You said shelter in place, taking that literally, not just the normal tents or other structures in terms of shelter, but emergency shelter kits. You know, for example, for those people that may not be in a place where they have a plot of land in what would be considered a camp, but are they being housed by a family that if you basically do some minimal shelter repairs to a storage unit or what have you, that can make a place that they can shelter safely for an extended period of time or a short period of time, depending upon displacement. So we're trying to take every scenario into account in terms of being able to whether or not reach people who cannot leave, which is more difficult, but also be able to reach people that aren't able to get to the camps that are being established currently or don't have the capacity to be able to support all of those populations.
Yes, this gentleman here.
Hi, my name is Ali Ramadan, and I work for the American Bar Association Center for Human Rights, and I'm originally from Iraq. So maybe Mr. Lukman can help me with this. Recently, some Iraqi NGOs and attorneys, human rights attorneys, contacted our center. They wanted us to help them with the issue of demolishing some Arab villages in the north of Iraq, on the borders of Kirkuk and other close by areas. And they wanted us to raise the issue with the US government and some international bodies. So I was wondering, we haven't verified the information, we hadn't taken any steps, we received the information early this week. So I was wondering if you have some information about this issue.
I mean, I think it's the same case I was talking about, or similar case I was talking about. Now that people think that the military side is on a winnable and predictable and controllable, so now we need to start scoring some justice to what happened. So there was an element of intertribal aspect of it. And the problem you have is if central government cannot have control of that area, or that sometimes people think that you need to give them breathing space for their politics to fix out because we have bigger challenges or more urgent issues to address, then people become victims of that. It's a legal problem we have as to how justifiable that is. Ethically, it becomes a problem. And also politically, it becomes a problem. I don't think there is a clear rule of engagement on that yet, to be honest. And I'm fearful that such an example might be repeated, which leads to further marginalizations of societies and labeling that these were collaborators, and therefore they have to be displaced elsewhere. To me, as I said, this is not an sectarian issue, it's a tribal problem.
Yes, ma'am.
Hi, Emily Gallagher with New America. I had questions regarding the camp and a little bit about perception and how you're building them based off of, I could see there's a problem between flexibility versus security. Like these people who have a shame of being refugees, do you let them come and go as they wish where there might be security issues, or do you make them stay how long do you expect them to leave or stay? And then as far as making it a long-term place, that permanency makes it a perception that they are refugees versus something that it's needed, rather than a short-term place where it's, if you get what I'm saying, it's a perception versus a reality kind of thing that you're dealing with that could be hard to tackle in this hard situation.
Thanks for the question. We don't make the decisions on the part of those that are displaced. The decisions for them to move are their own. So in terms of leaving particular areas and deciding to return, I mean, I think there are concerns, as I mentioned from the top, of potential precipitous returns to areas that may not yet be secure, or may be booby-trapped, or other security issues facing those returning families. I think we saw that a bit in Kirkuk, and in terms of learning some of the lessons from previous offensives, that's being taken into account in Mosul. I think in terms of displacement, it's not a choice that anybody makes. And to become a refugee certainly isn't a choice that anyone makes, that people want to stay close to home, they want to go back home. I think in this particular case, there has been a clear part of the strategy in the communication between the government and the UN and humanitarian organizations is that it is hoped that the displacement is short-lived, that the areas are cleared, that they're made safe, and that people then would be able to go back rather quickly. Because as you note, the longer people are displaced, the longer that becomes a more permanent feature, and it's more difficult to return, it's more difficult to reintegrate, it's more difficult to restart their family lives, employment, et cetera. So we would like it to be as short as possible, but not at the expense of the safety of people.
There is another element, only just if you want. The perception versus reality, if everything says, well, there is ethnic cleansing going on in that town or whatever, people will are fearful to go back. And sometimes that's not the case. It's also more political power or so on. So to me, getting the right accuracy of information for the media to reflect right on what's taking place is an important factor. We saw that in Tikrit, we saw it elsewhere. There were abuses, I'm not denying that. What I'm saying, the scale of perception that there is an abuse prevented people from coming back by a few months rather than immediately. On the other side as well, it frightens people from leaving their homes, and therefore they become more hostage to the local ISIS fighters because people fearful are leaving their homes that they don't want to be displaced. And that in itself is another challenge for the government. How do you get that balance right? The media have a responsibility. The government also has an assurance responsibility there.
You had a question, and then I'll get you.
Thank you. Donna Kalabi, Refugees International. Mr. Ambassador, I wonder if you could explain what you mean by tribal. You've used that expression several times, and I think that would help, because I think you're using it in a way that I'm not familiar with, not comparable. And the other thing, you also talked about a vacuum, a political vacuum in the country, which is very serious, obviously. And what the prospects are for that vacuuming being overcome. Obviously, Mosul has been an issue for many years, the whole question of what its future was going to be. So, and we see that. And my question for Kelly is the operations, the humanitarian operations on the ground, do they have an ability to operate in the different areas where different people are leading the campaign? So, you know, we have Iraqi forces, we've got Peshmerga, we've got various Turkish forces. Mm-hmm. Is an easy access, humanitarian access, is it equal?
Mm. Yeah, sure. Tribal, I meant that, for example, in Jabur or others, people perceive this that this is Sunni Shi'i. In reality, it's within the tribe. They see that they have to cleanse, or they have to revenge, or they have to score points, or they have to expel people within the tribes because it's shameful for them to have members of ISIS or members who collaborate with the government, whatever. So it's more intra-tribe. The governments have been asked to get participate, but whenever we do, these blood money and other becomes sort of quadruple the price of that. So people take advantage of that to resolve the issues. It's a tribal. It means, for example, this issue is in that tribe. It's not ethno-sectarian, it's not even political, it's people within tribes itself. So some tribes have collaborated within the tribe, some collaborated with ISIS, and when people go back, they see revenge, killing taking place. It's more within tribes rather than politically driven issues. As to the vacuum is, there is a national vacuum taking place, there is a local vacuum. In the IDPs is more local vacuums, so local representatives who need to negotiate with the government. So the government says, okay, these parliamentarians or committees or political leaders who are elected need to look after these issues. But these officials have lost credibility in their communities. So then people, allegations of corruption and lack of transparency becomes an issue. The government is trying to work on a larger reconciliation between Sunni Shi'i Kurds and so on. But in relation to the IDPs, it's more, I would say, nuances, and it's more operationally rather than nationally.
And Don, specifically on your question, in short, it depends very much, given the collaboration we have with the government of Iraq, to the extent that those other forces are working in alignment with the government, then we have that kind of access that we would have if it was a force controlled by the Iraqi government specifically. Those that may not be necessarily as tightly aligned, the access is much more difficult.
Thank you. My name is Lucy, and I'm from Yazidi Relief Fund. So, and if I may, to take your attention to the little bit different region, the refugees from Mosul are fleeing to northern Syria. Does UN have any project to support or assist northern Syria with accepting these refugees? And since I have an opportunity, if I may, there is no humanitarian aid that whatsoever goes to northern Syria from United Nations.
You just answered your question then.
No. I'm talking about, do you have any projects to support northern Syria with assisting refugees from Mosul? But yeah, as of today, the help yeah with prior issues have never went to the northern Syria.
So to the extent that the Syria operation now is happening in the current engagement, it has been focused on El Hol, which is a camp, obviously, that we established also 25 years ago. So in terms of the assistance that we may be able to provide, obviously, we're trying to expand our reach and using the Syria team to do it. Our access inside Syria, obviously, is also greatly constrained, depending upon the region. So that has been difficult, but we're trying creative ways with the UN team and local partners to try to get aid also to those Iraqis that may be fleeing to Syria to seek safety.
Yeah. I'll take two questions.
Thank you. Thank you very much. My name is Guillermo Fernandez, and I come from the Embassy of Spain. And I had like two questions. Well, first of all, thank you very much for having such a complementary like interventions, no? The humanitarian and more the political aspect. So for Mrs. Clements, my question is, how do you see the cooperation between the regional government of the Kurdistan, Iraqi Kurdistan, and Baghdad? How do you see, there's like a very good cooperation in terms of humanitarian aspects. And for Mr. Faily, my question is, we think that after the liberation of Mosul is going to be like a turning point in terms of making ISIS and making Daesh a terrorist group to lose territory. But that is that going to reduce or say like remove completely the terrorist violence carried out by Daesh in Iraqi territory?
There was another question here. Yes.
Rochelle with Mennonite Central Committee. One of the things that we're hearing concern from staff in Iraq is that the needs of IDPs in places like Anbar are being neglected with all of the focus on Mosul, and I'm just wondering if you could address that concern.
Thank you.
Good, both I think for me.
In
terms of the issues related to the collaboration between Baghdad and Erbil, actually it's quite strong and getting stronger. And I have to say, in terms of the planning, where displacement would happen, how it would happen related to the Mosul offensive, this is probably unprecedented collaboration between the governments in terms of the location and placement. Because as you know, the northern part of the country has been heavily saturated in terms of the Syrian refugees that have sought protection and safety there. Feeling very overwhelmed, both at a host community level, but also in some of the camps that have been put together. The response, obviously, has been tremendous on the part of the Kurdish regional government. And I think there was a tremendous spotlight on the capacity to be able to expand for additional displacement. And that's something that that it has taken collaboration between the Baghdad planning process. We've tried to facilitate that through the UN humanitarian country team in terms of our own engagement, but there's also, and obviously the ambassador can speak further to this, there's also, we've seen the results of the direct collaboration too between the governments. The issues of humanitarian assistance in the country, that has been a long-term issue. You know, it was only a year, maybe 18 months ago, when I was on this part of the world, this account more closely, where we were talking about an unprecedented and over, in terms of the portfolio of humanitarian assistance, much more going to the north than going to other parts of the country. And Anbar was part of it, but also south and central were also of concern. this is something that we look at across the board. We're trying to bring the requirements to the attention of all. I think Mosul has been so much a part of our planning process for so long that obviously that's where the focus is now. That's where the active engagement is, and that's where most of the displacement's happening. But that doesn't mean that it's to the exclusion of either our refugee response or the 3.3 million IDPs that have been now, of course, in need of humanitarian assistance for some time. But it's a challenge, and it's a challenge to continue to keep world attention and focus on the needs throughout the country, not just in the Mosul area.
I think within the government, I don't see it as that they've lost focus on Anbar because we have a Mosul operation. I think we've been able to, as a government, have an extensive program to deal with these issues. The turning point has been when the people, politicians and others, have said enough with terrorism. That has taken place. I'm confident about that. And therefore, areas of cooperation, unprecedented collaboration and others will take place. However, if you tell me that, would you be able to guarantee that, I say no, because the political mechanisms is not there. The collective will of the people to get rid of terrorism has taken place. And therefore, I don't see a sudden return of any type of ISIS. However, I will say that will be conditioned on the new political politicians, new generation of politicians to deal with the generational challenges we have. On the other side, as to terrorism, ISIS as a theme will be would stay. ISIS as a brand, yes, it will go. So because the control of the land will not be there, and therefore, but they may change more into terrorist and insurgency mode. And they are capable of doing that. They are organic enough to be able to, dynamic enough as well to be able to do that. But as a theme in relation to violence and so on, yes, that's a generational challenge. And we've seen that globally, it's not just in Iraq. Sectarianism is still there as a theme in the region, which means that ISIS and other type of entities will always be developed or produced. I think the Iraqis mentally now had enough from the violence of these issues. Now they need a way out. They need collaboration with the international community, interlocutors on humanitarian and others, to show that people are interested in Iraq for the sake of Iraq, not because of oil, not because of any other ulterior motives.
On that note, I thank you for coming. Please join me in thanking our speakers for a wonderful presentation.
Appreciate it.
Listen, anytime you want to come.